app purchases happening? No. So consumers like India, like their population, like their consumer behaviors, 100% like India, they don't spend money. They don't spend money inside games. They like free installs. So if you really want to create a game, which is like a great test bed, Indonesia is a great market, it's a great land grab happening. The Chinese are spending a lot of money there. The Japanese gaming studios are spending money there. Why? Because you know, no one can say who will win the game, but are these people spending money? Can you spend a dollar today and say that, okay, within 6 months, I will have a great grossing game coming in from Indonesia? Answer is no. So Thailand, that's my favorite market, and that is the largest market for mobile gaming in Southeast Asia. Thailand is already reaching a stage where it's around a $200 million market overall from a gaming point of view. Mobile gaming itself is around $100 million. It is the fastest growing and the largest market in Southeast Asia. Interesting stat about Thailand is that from an in-app purchase point of view, around 40% people have experience doing purchase in a Play Store or through one of the messaging Play Stores like Line, which is quite dominant there. People don't mind spending around $5 every month. So it's a great market. From a consumption perspective, this is a great market to target from a Southeast Asia point of view. From a segment perspective, I think there are around 20 million people in the Thailand market who are active on the mobile devices, out of which around 11 million active mobile gamers. So I think that's a great market to serve out to. Vietnam, it's fairly new in terms of the whole mobile growth, I would say. But the way it's catching up with the other markets is tremendous. Last year, from a mobile gaming point of view, Vietnam did a number of around $40 million, which is almost equi-sized to Indonesia. So over the next 2 years, we'll see the Vietnamese market growing out to becoming much bigger than Indonesia without even having that kind of population size. So tremendously great market, but I think the problem in the Vietnamese market is that it's not a very Play Store friendly market. Mostly it's driven by the local Play Stores, by the local app stores, very highly Chinese influenced market. So a much, much tougher market to crack, but definitely that's where the potential is. So what kind of games are people playing in Southeast Asia? I think that's the most interesting question. And just to give a little perspective, again, comparison vis-a-vis to India and to China. So in China, I met a couple of friends from the Chinese gaming community who are here at PG Connect, and it's a very MMOG kind of a market, right? You know, that's what we hear always, Chinese market is all about that. India, it's card games. We're seeing what Moonfrog is doing, what Octo is doing. I think the card games are doing a decent job. They're making money. Southeast Asia is still more in terms of, I would say, every country is different in its own way. If we talk about Indonesia still more towards card games. I would say card and casual games, actually. So, you know, it's more the Candy Crushes of the world, which are doing much better. They want still simpler games. The reason being is that the typical device which people in Indonesia are using are very low cost. It's a very Android one kind of a market. You need to create games for devices which are $50 to $75. I think that's what you need to keep in mind. So Indonesia is right there. Thailand is more mature. Thailand and Vietnam are actually more mature. In Thailand, actually, our single-player RPG games are doing much, much better. The kind of devices these people invest in, especially from a mobile phone perspective, it's 2x the average, the consumer average in the Southeast Asian market. So that's really exciting. So as a game developer, I think that's what I look for, is that, hey, are people spending in upgrading their devices quite faster? Do they have great memory? Are they more open to a little bit more advanced games? Because as we know, the money is not there in the casual game. The money is in the strategy game. The money is in the RPGs. And I think that's where the Thai market is really spending money. Vietnamese love strategy games. So I think that's something very similar to the Chinese market. Vietnamese really like strategy games. And that's why everyone is looking at Vietnam as the next potential market in Southeast Asia, where they can expect a lot more of in-app purchase to happen, or a lot more dollars for the gaming studios to build out. Because if you have active markets who like strategy games, then they're ability to pay and to subscribe from a lifetime value of a customer would be much, much better. So I think that's a good thing about the Vietnamese market. So beyond, of course, we talk about markets and we talk about the potential, but how do you really go about getting into these markets? India's I think so. From if I was to do a translation of the currency exchange between Singapore dollars to India, I think so. We're still talking of 50 rupees to a dollar. So they're still very expensive markets from a UA perspective. But just to give you a few cheat codes and few insights on how does these markets really work. So from in Thailand market, and you know, again, I'm again trying to peg it to the Indian market, and I'm taking Facebook as a benchmark. That was the cost of acquisition on user on Facebook instead of Google. So let's say if in India, a typical paying customer from Facebook comes in at a cost of around $1.50 to $2. That's the average which I hear from gaming studios for a paying customers. In Thailand, it is actually cheaper. Thailand is actually cheaper. The reason being is there are more amount of people who are actually paying, so they're less harder to find as far as India is concerned. You are able to acquire a consumer between 75 cents to a dollar. So it's much friendlier market as far as Thailand is concerned. Indonesia, again, depending on the kind of game which you're trying to seed in, because again, it's very, very hard to find paying customers. I really don't even know the maths that how much it's costing to find a paid customer. But typically, the average cost per install is somewhat similar to India. So I'm assuming that $1, $1.50 is something it will cost you to get a paying customer in Indonesia. Vietnam is super expensive. Vietnam is super expensive. The reason being is that it's highly fragmented. You just can't use a Facebook. You just can't use a Line Messenger to actually acquire a consumer. You need to do a lot of alliances with the local app stores. You need to do a lot of alliances with the local telcos if you really want to get your game seeding. And the kind of rev shares they offer are really bad. So we're not talking the 70-30. We're talking 70% in favor of the telcos, 70% in the favor of the app store, and the developer making a much more smaller rev share. So I think that's a challenge. That's why it's more expensive to acquire consumers in these markets. From a general marketing point of view, I'm you know, again, you know, I can detail and talk more from a paid media point of view, but I think so. I want to share a couple of cheat codes, you know, if you want to test out the Southeast Asian markets and what are things you can really do. Southeast Asia has a lot of communities, a lot of gaming communities. I think that's something which is good about. I think so. India, we're just seeing that there are a couple of good online gaming communities which host around 10,000 to 15,000 people. But in these markets, we're talking about gaming communities of 30,000, 40,000 people. And there are multiple of them. And you know, I had done a blog post almost a year back. I'll share that link out, where I'd listed out around 25 of those communities across Southeast Asia, where they're more than happy to help out an indie get their game out, which means they're happy to help in cross-promotional platforms. They're happy to write articles about it. They're happy to help you, give you 300 users for you to try out your game and see how your game is really performing in those markets. I think that's the best strategy. That's the best strategy which I would recommend to any app developer, any indie trying to enter these markets. I think that's the strategy which you should look at. Second most important thing from a Southeast Asia point of view, and I would definitely say to try out, is that Line as a messaging platform. I think that's the most dominant messaging platform in these markets, let that be Vietnam, Indonesia, or for that matter, Thailand. I think so. That's where you can spend a little amount of dollars and actually get paying customers. So instead of spending a lot more time on Play Store and thinking how should I do user acquisition on Facebook, or I should do user acquisition on Google Play Store, I think so. That's where you should spend a lot more time, is that how can I get my game listed online? How can I get my game listed on Kakao and use their gaming app stores to actually get the first 100 users or the next 500 users? I think that's critically important. Beyond that, I think so. The most important thing which every developer should look at, and that's even for India, I'm seeing, is that you should make great videos. You guys are not making videos. You know, I think that's where the Indian gaming studios and indies are really lacking out, is that we guys are not making great videos about our games so that people can experience. You know, we're launching a title. It should be like a big Bollywood movie title launch, right? You know, it should have the whole song, the experience of the game out there. And the cost of the video production has come down tremendously. I hear people getting, you know, gaming titles, videos done in around 20,000 rupees and less than $500. I think so. That's where the investment is missing. And seriously, it has a great impact on when people are trying to discover your app. If you get your games out, if you create create YouTube videos, seed them in YouTube, get your friends to share them across social platform. Use that as an introduction to a gaming community instead of sending like a 200-300 word article about your game. I think that that's a big problem for the local gaming studio in the Indies. I think that's an important strategy which people need to invest in. And trust me, I have seen a great impact in terms of the user acquisition cost actually coming down if you've done great videos. I think so there was a great point Ujwal from Microsoft had made, is that you know, everyone knows that it's very important to have your Play Store listing right, but how much time actually are we really investing in doing great videos, doing great graphics for that? I know that's a very important point, and it makes a tremendous difference when you're going to a market like Southeast Asia, which is not an English-speaking market. Right, in Thailand, people like to consume content in Thai. In Indonesia, people like to consume content in Bahasa. Vietnam is Vietnamese, right? So you're entering a market which is not going to be English friendly anyway. So all your ASO techniques are going to go down in the drain. So you need good quality of content and your product to speak for itself. Video, that's your chance. That's your Holy Grail. That's where you need to spend and invest money on. Yeah, so I think so. I did mention this, you know, very, very clearly. I think so. Thailand is the biggest market. I think that's where everyone should spend time. As far as Southeast Asia is concerned, people can spend up to $10 a month. As far as Game Punchers is concerned. Micropayment solutions, so I think so. One of the important points is that it's not a Google Play Store market. It's not about that, hey, I've got my game going on Google Play Store, I've got my game going on App Store, on Apple, I'm pretty sorted. If you really are serious about building Southeast Asia, you would need to do those tie-ups with the micropayment guys. Just to give an example, in Thailand, 70 to 80% of the transaction happens through cards, gaming cards, cherry card, which is being sold in 7-Elevens in smaller supermarkets, as compared to people giving their credit card to the Google Play Store and doing transactions. So you need to keep these things in mind. And as I said, Line is the key to success in Thailand. It's not Google Play Store. Yeah, I think so. And just a brief about us. I didn't introduce myself. I'm a co-founder of a company called Tyroo. We are a large user monetization company which focus across these language markets. Our primary markets are India, Thailand, Indonesia, Korea, Middle East. So if you need any help in acquiring customers or in monetizing your audience in these markets beyond the amount of money which you can make from in-app purchases, we're happy to help out. Thank you. Thanks very much.
That's okay. That's all right. No, thanks very much for that. Coming up now, we've got a slight change to the schedule. So we were going to be having something about the Pakistani perspective on development, but unfortunately, visas caused slight problems. So instead, we've got Anurag Rana, who's going to be talking to us about his game that he made in conjunction with the Indian Air Force, which is very interesting. So could we have a round of applause, please?
Thank you very much, everyone. Wakey, wakey, rise and shine. The cavalry has landed. Okay, come on. So let's do this. Whoops, 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 whoops. This is absolutely wrong. We actually made a game where you were actually flying a jet and you were actually bombing someone deep down in Pakistan. If that's the Pakistani perspective, that's pretty sad. Ouch. Okay. Nevertheless. Well, the Pakistani perspective from that angle is going to be pretty sad. Okay, now we are talking. So we're talking about Guardians of the Sky. So gentlemen, this is a talk about how the Indian Air Force, which owns all the IP to this game called Guardians of the Sky, and got its game together. Okay, so the Indian Air Force, saving our butt since 1932. Okay, and not just ours. Okay. Well, the clicker doesn't seem to be working. Okay, fair enough. As I said, saving our butt since 1932, and since it's a West meets East, not just our butt, you know, the West's butt as well. For example, the Great Yemen Escape, the entire world is talking about how the Indian military mobilized all its forces, Army, Navy, Air Force, and got about 5,000 people out of the war-torn Yemen in a record-breaking time. Including, there are people from BBC or New York who are saying the US Air Force spends 10 times on their Air Force, but when it comes to their citizens hiking out of Yemen, they're asking them to give or hike a lift with the Indian Air Force. Okay, now here is also a big corollary or something which is very weird lies. We in India never really got to hear a lot about it. So we on Facebook are talking about people are gaga in Japan about Operation Rahat, what the Indian military did, but somehow over here the local media is not covering it, which is exactly the point. Good news is seldom news. People are always looking at controversial stuff. And in all this, the current pop culture and all, there are some questions which personally pain quite a few of us, which is this freedom of speech which media everyone talks about, and you're talking about who's doing what. No one is talking about what the Indian forces are doing. The common youth out over there, you ask them, who are your idols? Maybe some Bollywood star, maybe some cricketing fan. Who are your heroes? Who do you look up to? No one talks about the soldiers who's standing over there at the border with a gun. The point is, freedom and independence, it is not free. It costs soldiers. There's some of us to whom it really pained that somehow the entire psyche of the nation was not really knowing what our armed forces have done in the past and what is it that they're up to. That was not acceptable. So here are a couple of cool guys. I mean, one of them, but Bharat, his name Bharat actually means India. Now, he comes from the city Palampur, which has given India 2 to 3 Paramveer Chakras. For the Brits, it's like the Victoria Cross. For the Americans, it's like Medal of Honor. I am Anurag. I happen to be a pilot and a programmer. I went to a military college, but instead of joining the Air Force, I went and simply did my engineering. And the third guy is actually an Indian Air Force veteran. So he was bombing, flying his MiG-21 on the Kargil Heights during the 99 Kargil War. So we guys came together and we said, well, this is not acceptable. We are going to make some sort of a playing field, and we are going to bring out the stories related to the Indian Defense Forces. So we came together sometime in early 2013, and no money, nothing, no profit motive, no nothing bothering about monetization. We simply wanted to tell stories, and the stories which we chose were about our soldiers. So the first thing that we made was a YouTube animation. We didn't sell it, we just posted it, we just made it. It was an itch which we wanted to scratch. So the first production was an announcement. It was made by just three guys. It was about the Kargil War and how the Indian helicopter pilots braved the odds. They did not have any anti-missile elements, yet they went on those heights and then they fought across. Some of them lost their lives, they got their awards, but this was our tribute to them. Next, what we did was, we said, well, fair enough, an animation is really passive. You're seeing what's happening across over there. Now look at you guys. See, the entire USAF, United States Air Force Communication on one side, Tom Cruise in Top Gun on one side. What has captured your imagination or got you to learn more about the Air Force? So similarly, we said, now we're not going to ask you to watch Tom Cruise. We're asking you to become Tom Cruise. Fly and complete the mission. So the very first game which we made, once again, just the three of them. Okay, one guy who wrote the script, I was the programmer, Bharat was the designer, and we made something called Operation Morning Glory. We released it on Android just to see whether we knew our stuff. We got about a 2 lakh download. So we said, okay, fair enough, not bad, word of mouth, seems we know how to do game development. Just about them, the Air Force, in the name of the President of India, came across with this ad. We are looking to make a mobile game. Are you up to it? When this came, we said, bloody hell, we are the guys who are going to win it. If there is anyone who's going to make this game, it's going to be us. So with all pomp and all, we went across on that date. I think it says August 2013 somewhere. And you know who we find? We find Disney over there. We find Reliance Games across over there. So that is a competition. Big billion people, big billion-dollar companies, thousands of people versus this company with about 2-3 people. You know, we were going across over there. Disney was enamoring everyone, even the Air Force officers. They're like, okay, come talk about what you have done. So our strategy was, well, we're not going to leave. So now any government acquisition process is long. It's bloody long as hell. Disney wore out. I mean, they did not even come to the final sessions, but Reliance was there all across. So there was a pre-bid one, then there was a pre-bid two, all across 1 to 1.5 months. Then there was a technical evaluation, then there was a technical evaluation two, and finally there was a commercial bid. That's what we said. If we go so far, we're going to be bloody dirt cheap compared to anyone else. And that's exactly what happened. So when the bids were announced, we were the lowest quote, and yes, we won the award. But that's when the battle started. Make the design document. And here's the thing, none of us was actually a game developer. We actually learned project management on the go. We had to, you know, take internal loans because it was a government contract. In place of they paying you, you have to pay them first and say, hey, we are serious about this. And we are going to get this money out when we do the project. So we got the money in and crunch, crunch, crunch. The next 2 months, all of us were putting about 100 hours a week. So that's 7 days a week, about 14 hours every day. We came across with this fictitious country called Zaruzia. Our brief was, you got to use fighter aircrafts, you got to use transports, you got to use helicopters, you got to have various time of days, you got to have various weathers, you got to have mountains, you got to have seas. And all of this was essentially put in a story where the story is this, some fictitious neighbor country which is politically unstable, militarily dominant, has a coup, and the military leader kicks out the civilian leader and says, hey, our neighbor country is doing much better, you political leaders are not doing much, so in one stroke, I'm going to get rid of you and I'm going to attack the other country. Well, it sounds like, you know, a neighbor country, that's just like a piece of fiction. But with this, we went into the actual game production. Now, you remember Bharat, the guy we talked about, he had no clue, he had never flown in a plane, and he was the one who was supposed to do level design. So he said, well, better than getting you into a commercial flight jet, we actually put him in a plane, tossed him around, he came out kissing the earth, but by this time he had the perspective of what earth and aircrafts look like from this perspective. And this quality shows in the game. So, well, we went across with the design, good old school tools, no funky diagrams and all. So we just said, well, we got to do for all these devices. So we just used simple pieces of paper, drew some sketches, Android fragmentation, fair enough, no problem. Make it on the biggest possible tablet. And what will it look like? Small screens? Well, just fold it and this is what it'll look like. Pretty much that's how we ideated, went across to a good ergonomic design, and finally had a good user interface. Now, if you have ever flown a plane, which someone amongst you might have, you see there is so much instrumentation, and on a mobile screen where the real estate is already so limited, we wanted all that information. We wanted you to have throttle, fire, weapons, countermeasures, ammo status, steering, where you're headed, where you're pointing at, what's your horizon line, radar, where the enemy are, everything in a very non-obtrusive manner. We achieved it. But it was a tightrope walk. Who are our game testers? Air Force officers, okay? They fly these aircrafts all the time and they wanted more and more and more and still more realism. They wanted aircrafts to stall, they wanted realistic physics. But what we said, hey listen, it's gonna be played by young guys who have never actually flown a plane. So it was a difficult task for us to manage Air Force officers' requirement at one end, yet keep the game appealing and approachable for young players. Now, the seriousness of the Air Force could be gauged by the factor. They said, hey, listen, we want you guys to make a game where a user actually steps into the uniform of an Air Force pilot. And these guys are so fanatical about an Air Force uniform, they have a 100-page manual which talks about what should be the length of the medal, how many mm should be the width of the top pocket, how many mm should be the width between the two buttons. And we said, fair enough. And this was exactly the same amount of fanatism which we put. So when we came across the user interface, that's your home screen. That's where you type your name. That's where your name comes across. That if you're playing the game, you're XYZ, it comes across over there. When you finish the training mission, and we had a very elaborate training mission, how an Air Force officer approaches and flies the aircraft. Till you don't do the training mission, you don't get the wing. As and when you complete missions, you get medals. So everything was finally put down across in an Air Force approved, strictly manual user interface. But all this is becoming really, really heavy. And now what we had to do was, Indian consumer, everyone talked about bandwidth conscious, okay? Now this is the most boring slide. I don't like put graphs and all, but the equivalent game on iOS is about 800 MB. We packed it all in about 130 MB. That's still a lot, but there was a heavy optimization. All those uniforms which you talked about, all the optimization techniques, occlusion, making sprites, making atlases, the last fumes of a sub 10,000 device with about 512 MB of was made compliant with. The result? Oh, yeah, by the way, Unity 3D was the workhorse where we implemented it all. And after this, let me just simply show you what the result looked like. We'll be right back. Thank you very much. So gentlemen, we had the various, we had the transport, we had the fighters, we had the helicopters flying across deserts, seas. That's the Bombay city. So the final mission is you're flying over the city of Bombay and protecting it from the enemy. Deserts, there is an air-to-air refueling mission with a cockpit view, and there is a night vision view where you go and deep down into the enemy area, you drop down commandos and give them air support. And finally, the day of judgment, Indian Air Force is the fourth biggest air force in the world. In its arsenal, it holds nuclear weapons. And we, a ragtag studio of just a couple of people, are here standing pretty to be the next big arsenal into the chief of the Indian Air Force, who released our game to the audience in the Air Force headquarters. Well, it immediately rose the ranks and, kick. The Bollywood game, which was made by Disney, well, we actually managed to kick them aside, and our game, with no advertisement, pure word of mouth, pure quality, beat a Disney production to be number one on the Indian App Store, at least on the Windows. And not just Windows, we're talking about, you know, East meets West. Here we are on the US App Store. Not just US. Once again, West meets East. We're talking about Rovio. We're talking about all the Scandinavian countries who make games over there. Rovio makes games. They're featured across over here. Here we are, Finland, Sweden, Denmark. And we got managed to be featured. There was absolutely no advertising. There was no advertisement budget. It was purely word of mouth quality of the game. User feedback, okay? As we talked about West, East. So we got a user talking about, hey guys, till now I was only playing American games. It was the first time that I actually got an Indian game, which I felt like playing, and I felt good playing this game. There is a chap who said, you know what, I have got admission into an Indian Air Force Academy. I feel by playing this game, I'm actually really getting to understand what an Air Force pilot does. Similarly, there's a guy who says, you know what guys, I could never become an Air Force pilot, but by playing your game, I feel like I am an Air Force officer. We got all these emails where a chap is saying, I gave up on gaming. I was like a kid, I used to play games, but now games, I don't get it. It's only when I played your game that I'm actually beginning to play, and I feel like there's a first game in years which I actually wanted to live and play and finish. And there's another chap, you remember we talked about Ab Initio Pilot, he says, I use this game to teach my son how to handle an aircraft. Okay, so over there, we will say mission accomplished, which is all also be reflected pretty decently. So we got about 40,000-50,000 people on the whole who have ranked it about to be 4.25 plus. Our average download still data are about 1.5 million. No advertisement, absolutely nothing, and growing. And finally, Microsoft gave us the best app or game from India award. So those are some accolades, some learnings. It's okay to follow your heart, but take your head along. This was
amazing. I thought you were just a crazy person when I met you earlier, but you got some substance behind you. I wanted to put my, just a bit of advertising actually. That should be at Monty Munford on Twitter. I lived in Goa for 2 years, 2008-2010, and quite big in the DJ scene there. So a friend of mine, Sasha, it's a Russian tech DJ, is playing tonight in Bangalore. So I'm going to put on my Twitter page where he's playing. And Sasha, if you just stand up. There he is. He's a genius, and you have a great night out. And we're all going to have a great night out.
Is that where the after party is?
Well, Sasha was telling me there's an after party after his party. So that sounds much more interesting. You know what I mean? Anyway, apart from social entertainment, welcome to the panel. We're probably going to run through it quickly. I think you've met two of the guys. They don't need to introduce themselves, especially you. So Pocket and Oliver, please tell us a couple of minutes about yourselves and then we'll crack on.
Well, you've already heard from me in the previous talk, but Oliver Jones from Moonfrog raised $50 million from Sequoia Capital and Tiger Global. We make games for India. That's our target. Originally from Zynga.
That explains a lot, yeah.
Okay. Well, I've been in gaming for now almost 8 years. Got a chance to work with MMO, Flash, PC, iOS, Android, HTML5. And in the last 6 months, I've been extensively working in the Southeast Asia region, spending a lot of time with the local gaming community over there, meeting all the gaming companies over there, understanding the pains, very similar to India, but they are still more pains over there, which obviously we'll talk now. But that's it, and as a company, we help them make money. So,
thank you. So the subject matter is like delving deeper into SAARC. Sorry, absolutely. How's that? So SAARC, so I didn't know what that was. I thought that was like the Philippines or something like that, but it's obviously a loosely knit alliance of countries around India. So once we managed to work out that what that was quite good. So we were talking about, Anurag, about, you know, you were saying one thing you said to me earlier, apart from, you know, the Royal Air Force and all that, is that mobile games could be the new cricket across that SAARC region. Tell me more about that.
Well, the SAARC region, pretty much there is only one thing which unites them right now, which I can say is pretty much the Cricket World Cup. Okay, so there was Afghanistan, there was Pakistan, there was India. Well, there was not Bhutan, but there was Sri Lanka, and then there was Bangladesh. And they were battling it out on the cricket fields. Now, the Cricket World Cup cannot go on forever, can it? But I believe if gaming is the continent or the subcontinent's passion, and this is where they like to do the two hands with each other, you know, I think it's pretty much easier to connect and, well, in the spirit of adventure and competition, take that across onto a mobile game where these guys can actually play it out. And what we've actually seen is, you know, some of these differences, and these countries sometimes, they do have, you know, the minute differences across on each other. I believe if you could only engage, connect, and maybe do that with a mobile game, I think that could be a good thread to bring the subcontinent together.
And it seems like a, you know, a pretty friendly organization. I mean, obviously Pakistan is a bit different, but I think when it comes to entrepreneurs and entertainment, I spent time in Ramallah, in the West Bank in Israel. You know, you can't believe how much outsourcing goes to Palestine from Tel Aviv, companies such as Google and Microsoft. And most entrepreneurs, they don't really care about politics. I mean, maybe they should, but, you know, it's an opportunity for people to work together, you know. So my man here knows quite a lot about Pakistan, describes it as a emerging $10 million market or an app market.
Yeah.
We'd love to know about more about that.
Is this working? Yeah, great. Well, yeah, I'm not an expert in Pakistan, I think, so I think so. I know a little bit much more than these guys on the panel. But from a Pakistan point of view, it's not a great mobile gaming market. It's not a very big gaming market. It's around a $750 million mobile gaming market, but it's all exports. So a lot of gaming studios which have come up over the last 7-8 years, but most of the guys are doing exports. Just to give an example, he talked about cricket. The 2011 World Cup official game was done by a gaming studio in Pakistan. So yeah, you know, these guys have great talent. From a consumer perspective, just a small stat, if India is a $100 million market from an in-app purchase point of view, Pakistan is 1/10 of our size. So it's just a $10 million market. And the reason being for that is that Pakistan is only a 15 million smartphone device market. That's about it. So there's around 150 million mobile devices in Pakistan, only 15 million smartphone devices. So that itself tells a lot about Pakistan. And one interesting stat which I like about Pakistan, and that's why I did the research, was that unlike India, which is 98% Android market and 2% iOS, Windows Phone, and so forth, Pakistan is on the smartphone side 28% iOS market.
Oh,
yeah, so you know those guys can afford their phones.
And a similar market in Bangladesh as well, right?
Absolutely. From a revenue side, I think so Bangladesh is doing a little bit much better than Pakistan. I think the last number I heard was around $25 million market, so it's a little bit better. But I think so from a capability point of view, from a population size point of view, I think so Pakistan is a much better opportunity because, again, it's an iOS-friendly market. Bangladesh is, again, 98% Android. So, yeah, you can't make much money going forward there.
So by definition, within that kind of organization, Mr. Pocket, sorry, I forgot your name, dude.
Nimit,
sorry, man. So India's obviously going to dominate, right?
Yeah.
Do you think so? And what do you think will happen after that? Do you think that India will become a hub for talent? There will be talent that will come from SAARC into India? Or how will it kind of pan out? So, Nimit.
Yeah, so one of the learning that I have got while meeting with all the Southeast Asian developers, they all are very interested in coming to India. But the biggest problem is they all see that as an opportunity, but they all are afraid to come to India. They don't know how to come to India, how to approach the market. And just to add on to that thing, when I was speaking with all of them, It was very interesting that when I asked them, do you know your own market? They themselves didn't know their own market. You know, so they're... well, that is something which, you know, I'll maybe say off the record. But obviously, there's a lot of interest from those markets to come to India. There's going to be a lot of more competition coming to India from Southeast Asian developers. The kind of games that I'm seeing over there, trust me, guys, they have some really good games. But yes, they don't know how to come to this country. So we are still safe for a couple of years.
Logistically, I mean, I was asked to do something in California a couple of years ago. So I went to Africa to get some entrepreneurs and developers to go up against North American counterparts like mobile advertising, mobile this, mobile that. And there was a very cool guy in Lagos, and he said, I mean, you're having a laugh. You know, if you can't pay for those guys to get there, they're not going to get visas. You know, and that would be something maybe that London should be heading, fast-track entrepreneurial visas. How easy is it for someone in SAARC to get a visa to work in India? Is that easy to do?
Well, yes, for sure. I don't think that's a problem. Obviously, we're not talking about Pakistan guys getting a visa, because I think that's one of a big...
That's a bigger challenge,
that's
right?
That's a big challenge. But no, I don't think so. That's at all a problem. And they are quite open, and obviously we all know that they can travel to each of the countries without a visa also, so they are well connected on that.
And just to add to that, I don't know how many people know that, but Google's India head, he's from a Sri Lankan origin, from SAARC. So, you know, India is pretty free from a country perspective, I think. So beyond Pakistan, as you said rightly, everyone has a free to come to our country. We have great work policies available, so you can definitely get good talent to come into our markets and work from here. Yeah.
There is something I want to add across to that.
I've got...
Okay. Yeah, you go ahead first.
Just a perspective on that. Foreigners coming in to SAARC to set up a business, like first-hand experience, it's actually very tough. It's a bit of a walled garden, to be honest, because, as you know, foreign... you can't invest in an Indian company above 50% currently. And the visa system really is not set up for a foreigner to come and really start a business. You either need a sponsor from your home country and a sponsor in India, or you come under a employment visa, which is when you have a company in India who's employing you. But when you have no company to employ you, you're setting one up, and there's really nothing. It's not built set up for that at all.
Yeah, we're not used to people coming and setting up business out here. No, we like to do everything ourselves. No, but from a policy's perspective, I think so for SAARC, there's a different work policy. As compared to people coming from the US or from the UK. We have a different work policy for people. We have a more, just to give an example, of course, now the visa on arrival policy, which Prime Minister Modi is working on, has improved a lot of things. But other than that, even before that, India had a great visa on arrival policy for 14 countries, practically outside of Pakistan. Even Afghanistan has a visa on arrival for us. So I think so that's, it is pretty friendly from a work permit perspective.
Yeah. And I think it's about the British immigration service towards Indians when they want to come into our country. That's why they make it so tough for us. Which is fair enough, you know what I mean? Sorry.
Fair. Okay, thank you very much. So the thing which you had initially asked was, can India give an environment where all these regional SAARC countries can come, make content, and then export it back across? So over here, the old minister, Shiv Tharoor, okay, he gave this talk. Over here, we talked about how India is like a... Well, he talked about a soft power, and he was talking about how the Indian export in terms of its entertainment industry is really overtaking all this. And the example what he gave about was Afghanistan. So the Indian soap operas were so popular across over there that when they were being aired at sometime, you know, about 7:30 or 8 in the night, the streets used to be deserted because people are huddled in their room and they're watching all these soap operas. And there were these thieves who went to a car, stripped it off everything, and wrote Tulsi Zindabad on the screen, because that was the name of the heroine which was the of Indian origin in that soap opera. So similarly, I believe there is a tremendous capacity for India to absorb a lot of cultural influences, which it still does, make a content which then can be exported back and could be really going across the boundaries and have a lot of acceptance in the entire, not just SAARC region, but also Africa as well as Southeast Asia.
Yeah, understood, absolutely. Do you think, is there a trend of Indians going to work in SAARC countries as well as the kind of Sri Lankan Google Indian person? There's a movement of Indians to say, right, I'm going to spend 6 months in Colombo, or
none that, unfortunately, which I am aware about.
No,
Especially in the digital media and the gaming vertical, actually, I've been meeting in both in Southeast Asia and South Asia. So if you go to Sri Lanka, Group M being WPP, right? I think so most of the hierarchy now reports into India, Southeast Asia office, and most of the talent is now going from here. Even actually, other than Pakistan, now Pakistan also reports into the Southeast Asia market for WPP. So yeah, there's a lot of talent which is moving. You go to Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and I'm not talking Southeast Asia, but I'm talking South Asia, Nepal. You go to the telecom side, you meet most of the people in the digital companies. You would find a lot of Indians there because I guess Indian market is little 2 or 3 years ahead of the other Southeast Asian market. So the talent is quite valuable for them.
We're going to have to rush on, I think. So just maybe just from left to right, you know, what's the future for delving into SARC? What do you think is going to happen in the next 12, 18 months?
Well, unfortunately, I personally have been looking at geopolitics. And there is a secret, there is a dark undertone which is at least taking across over here. So there is some turf war, there is a power play. On the whole, so while definitely there is going to be a tussle in terms of elbow room, people are going to look at across. But I think financially, initially what Oliver talked about, everyone has the same aspirations. So if the rest of the differences, for example, in terms of boundaries or the rest of the things of the past could be put across, I believe economically there is a tremendous advantage to gain. And I can't actually forecast, but actually rather hope that there is this cultural exchange and let these things come together, and maybe that's rather the future which I would hope for in place of making any speculations.
What I think is, one, obviously smartphone penetration is going to go more, right? That is one good thing that's going to happen to the gaming industry. Second, I'm not sure how many people will like me saying this, but I believe there is a Flappy Bird sitting in each of these countries. And it is going to explode somewhere. So after meeting the developers is what I could say this now, that when I look at their games, yes, they are going to explode. The revenue that they are not getting right now, someone is going to make in each of this country. The way Gear Studios made it in for Vietnam, it's going to happen in each of this country. So yes, that's going to come very soon.
One interesting thing, actually, Moonfrog has the number one gaming app in Pakistan currently, and Sri Lanka. And that sort of came as a surprise to me. Oh, we're number one, great. And you were saying there were $10 million in that region? I'd like to see that. But but maybe, you know, one day it'll come. I think there's been, what I sense, looking at the NRI community, like people leaving India, getting all that talent, sort of the talent exodus, the brain drain, I think in the coming years, you'll see that talent coming back and just realizing there's potential here and there's opportunity also.
I think so. My take is that remain focused on India. Over the next 3 years, I don't see the landscape changing a lot. If you do a great game for India, like he's saying that he didn't even know his game is number one in Pakistan, and his presentation was all about India, India, and India. So I guess that works. So yeah, just focus on India. India is an island. Let's win this territory. Let's take I'd say monetize the whole potential of the audiences out here. A billion is a big number to just live with.
Do we have time for questions? We've got a few minutes. Anyone ask any questions, or have an early lunch? Lady over there, please. Just introduce yourself, who you are, please.
Hi, this is Rina. I'm from the operator world. I work with Aircel. I have a question. I'm hearing again and again, this is 100 million in app market. If the operators were to open up billing, what do you think can be the size of the market? Because if I were to go back to Thailand, which I think has operator billing, it's very different from the other markets that you spoke about in your presentation.
That's an excellent question.
I just have a couple of... are you familiar with the introduction of operator billing in China and what impact that made on the monetization there?
No, in fact, I'm not.
Okay, so back in 2010, operator billing was really introduced and the rates became a lot more competitive. The revenues went up 10x.
So that's a $1,000 billion market.
Yep.
So it's absolutely. I think so. It's not only about opening up operator billing, but I think so rev shares. If we can please have rev shares 70-80% in favor of the developers, not in favor of the operators, then I think so. Yep, 10x. I think so. Even in China now. So if China can give 70-80% to app developers, I'm sure India can.
I'm sure.
Yes. Come on. Anyone else from telco other than Aircel?
I think it's very rare for an operator to come to these type of conferences, so you deserve respect from the panel completely.
I think all that I have to say, if the government were to reduce our spectrum charges, by all means we can do that.
It's the government's fault.
Thank you very much for your question. Anyone else have a question, or we'll have a nice early lunch? Okay, well listen, thank you very much. Thank you for my panelists for the insight
thank
and everything
you.
Like that, and thank you for those of you who stayed for watching. Yes. Thank you very much.